would be appropriate to have a few comments and a welcome. I had asked Dr. Fletcher Lampkin, who's the president of Kansas Wesleyan University, to maybe speak a little bit about the student center we're using and the university for just a few minutes, if he would like. So Dr. Fletcher Lampkin, the president of Kansas Wesleyan.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to have you here on our campus. Just a few words about Kansas Wesleyan, and I'll let you get on with your meeting. We're a university that's been in existence here in Salina for 125 years. We were founded by pioneers and members of the Methodist Church with a mission of integrating faith and learning to develop intellect and character at the collegiate level, and we've been doing that better and better every year for 125 years. We are very pleased to be a part of Salina. Salina is a great college town. It has wonderful facilities, opportunities for our students, both for professional development and for engagement in community activities and community service. We also contribute a lot to Salina, as any good university would, not only by the fact that we offer educational opportunities to students at the undergraduate and graduate level, and continuing education, a master's degree program for people wanting to continue their education. But we also provide a great deal of art, entertainment, music, and athletics to enrich the community. And probably something that most people don't know is that because of the money we spend, the people we bring in, and the way that we operate, our university contributes about $40 million of revenue to the city of Salina each year at virtually no cost to taxpayers. And if you look at private education across the state of Kansas, we require about 1% of the higher education budget for the state of Kansas, and yet turn out about 25% of those who achieve bachelor's degrees and 33% of master's degrees. That's a heck of a return on investment. So if you have, if you're not from Salina and you've got a private university in your region, support it and give it your not only your moral support, but your community support, because that university means a lot to the students to whom it provides opportunity and to the community itself. We're pleased to be a part of Salina, and Kansas Wesleyan is very pleased to welcome you here today. We try to turn out good citizens and people who are going to take care of this landscape, and it's good to see an organization such as yours, which, as Tom informed me, is committed to all things outdoors. Today, you're indoors, and you're in a new facility that we have built, again, through private funds. This facility is about a $12 million facility built about 3 years ago, or began operation about 3 years ago. Donations of private individuals, maybe Foundation and others, made this facility possible. It provides classroom space, administrative space, a wonderful basketball and volleyball venue, as well as a place for folks like you to come convene and enjoy an academic setting in comfort. We welcome you here. We're glad you're here. We hope you enjoy your time on our campus, and we hope that you have a very productive meeting. God bless you all for the good things you're doing for our state, for our community, and for our country. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, now we'll call the meeting to order. We'll start with by an introduction of the commission.
Randy Dahl, Leon.
Don Budd, Kansas City.
Robert Wilson, Pittsburgh.
I'm Gerald Lauber from Topeka.
Frank Meyer from Harrington.
Good afternoon. I'm Deborah Bolton from Garden City.
I'm Tom Dill from Salina.
Todd Workman, Topeka.
Linda Craighead, Topeka.
Chris Timeson, Legal Counsel.
All right. Is there any additional agenda items that we need to look at?
From the first agenda that was distributed, we have added under general discussion the wildlife rehabilitation update and remembered the rest of the items. 6, the 75th anniversary wildlife support fish restoration to the evening session, and added item number 7, public lands regulations that were not on the original agenda.
Okay. Let's get the minutes approved. Anybody have any comments about the minutes? Or if not, we want to go ahead and have a motion to have them approved.
I move that we accept them as presented.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any additional discussion? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. At this point in time, we would like to welcome and encourage any public comment on any item that is not on the agenda, both this afternoon or tonight. If you have anything you'd like to address the commission with, please come up, use the microphone. I encourage you to use the microphone, state your name and address, or name and town. There are people who are listening to us online and watching us online, and it's easier for them to hear the comments we have. So does anybody have anything that's for a non-agenda item at this time? Yes, please.
My name is Tim Donges with the Quality Deer Management Association. I live in El Dorado, Kansas. My wife here is passing out an email I sent out to Wildlife and Parks staff, and also a case study that was a gun case study, which was done in the state of Minnesota, which included Minnesota, Ohio, North Dakota, South Dakota, and Wisconsin. First thing I wanted to address was you guys received the copy of the Ohio bill that was passed in the state of Ohio. The one thing in that I brought up before for Chris Thomason, which I had a question for him, was there was a problem with not making it mandatory for restitution. The issue was, I think Chris stated that I'm not sure the organization, has to do with attorneys and judges, that they do not like mandatory. And the thing that we're having the biggest problem with is the discretion of judges and prosecutors on not taking wildlife laws seriously and knocking down the fines that you all recommend. And I didn't know if there was any way of fixing that or if there's any way around the mandatory issue.
Well, this is somewhat of a legislative item, which is going to be on the agenda next or shortly. But
okay.
The last time there was a wildlife law enforcement bill, it was proposed by the Wildlife Federation and went to the committee, and that seemed to be the stumbling block, and it was the Association of County Attorneys and District Attorneys, and I'm not sure the acronym, it's like KCDAA or DACA. Anyway, and they were the opponents for mandatory minimum sentencing because it took that discretion out of their control, and quite honestly, the bill wouldn't move unless those mandatory minimums were removed.
Okay. And so is there any other way around that, or is that just something we got to deal with?
I think it's either going to have to be a negotiated process with that association, which I'm not sure that they're willing to bend their position. I can't speak for them, but that was the position 4 years ago.
Is there a way that Kansas Department of Wildlife and Parks, can they have their own judges and prosecutors that are familiar with laws, familiar with game, and actually care?
If there was some sort of statutory authorization for it, but also, I'll talk about the legislature here in a bit, but
that's fine. I just wanted to ask that question. The thing with that Ohio bill, big thing on there, some states said that we don't care about our does, and they actually kept their fining system low on that part, which I feel if there's a doe standing out there or a mature buck standing out there, that poacher is going to take the mature doe over the buck. So to me, it's no difference in fines. We have a minimum base of, I'm suggesting a $1,000 fine as a minimum starting point, and then we use the scale on it from there from one with a Boone and Crockett Pope and Young system. The next thing I want to address is the trespassing. Some states have fines that range all the way up to a $5,000 fine for trespassing, and they do break this down into categories. The first category is actually the issue of just trespassing. Is somebody trespassing on your property to go fishing or whatever? There's no weapons involved. And what we're proposing is trying to get a fine system set up of, in the neighborhood of a $500 fine for trespassing itself. The next thing is does, as far as I'm aware of, Chris, and you can clarify this, and that is, we currently do not have a armed trespass law?
No, there's a criminal hunting statute, criminal which is different than regular trespass.
And is it substantially higher then on penalties? If somebody's walking across my property with a rifle versus not, is my game warden going to give him a different fine? Is it going to be a different statute?
There's a statute that is, if it's posted no hunting, like purple paint.
Sure.
So that's in our 32 series. There's a criminal law related. It's a 21 series law that's related to both trespass and then the criminal hunting. And the criminal hunting penalties are a little more significant, not substantially, but a little bit more.
Okay. What we're suggesting is a $1,000 fine if somebody trespasses with a weapon, because we feel that's a dangerous situation for our landowners out there. If they have to approach that person, they're putting their lives in danger, and I realize they're there to protect their property because they actually own it. The person trespassing has no tie to it. The other thing I have not seen for Kansas laws is if the person is intoxicated while in possession of a weapon, while committing a wildlife crime, there is no additional fine for that person being intoxicated while he's committing the crime with a weapon. Is that correct?
I think that's correct, yeah.
Okay. And what we're suggesting on that is to actually double the fine, because, again, that's a dangerous situation. We got a guy out there that's intoxicated with a weapon making poor decisions. The other thing we do see, and I think I brought this up in the last meeting, was let's go ahead and double the fine if the person is a repeat offender within 5 years, because obviously he didn't get it the first time. The next thing is that I had on my list here is the road hunting, which we all know is a problem in the state of Kansas. And one of the things that I want a clarification again here on this meeting, I believe it states in the statute that it says it's a non-KDOT road that you can road hunt off of. Is that correct or not? Or am I wrong on that?
That's not right. It's a public highway is defined, and I don't have the statutes in front of me, but it's a public way.
Public maintained
road. It's just a public way.
Public way.
So if it's a public access way, you can't shoot from it unless you've got permission from the landowner on the side you're shooting on.
Okay. The biggest thing we've realized when I've done a lot of this research in other states is that a lot of them are talking about the maneuver. When somebody does have permission to hunt on somebody's property, but they're shooting off the roadway, is a safe maneuverability of a long rifle or long gun, and how you're going to get that thing maneuvered in the vehicle in order to get it safely out the window to make the shot, if you're an ethical hunter. Most people, the general public that sees people hunting from the road, do not think you're an ethical hunter. And they feel it's a safety factor. And that's why I'm here today. The big paper I gave out to you guys is the gun case law that Minnesota is currently backing. They've had a gun case law since 1917 in the state of Minnesota. And the NRA actually looked at this and said, this is actually one of the better gun case laws out there because it has clear language. And that's the NRA's biggest problem with gun case laws is gray language in there. And the study actually shows that North Dakota and South Dakota, which has similar no gun case laws as what we have here in the state of Kansas, and they did a study over 10 years, and they used the, let's see what the name of that, Hunting Incident Clearinghouse as their statistics. And they did it over 10 years, and what they found was in the state of Minnesota that they had that South Dakota and North Dakota had 84% higher accident rate than the state of Minnesota, which had 6% over 10 years. To me, that's a huge, huge difference out there. I had somebody come up to me from the state of Iowa and say that we don't think it's working good in Iowa. Well, when I look through Iowa's laws, it's real general. It's not very well written. Gun case law. The other thing I see a problem with their gun case law is it's cheap. It's $25 and $50. You know, if we're going to have a law, it doesn't do any good if you're going to have $25 or $50. It doesn't deter anybody. Minnesota has a $250 fine for uncased weapon, and they have an additional, another $250 fine for a uncased and a loaded weapon. So you're going to cost you about $500. My proposal is let's go ahead and give them a $250 fine if we decide to do a case law. $250 fine for being uncased, and I want a $1,000 fine, because at that point, if it's uncased, loaded, that person's road hunting. And the public perception of that, of us hunters, is not good at all. It's why we're having problems as hunters getting access on land for people. My farmer or rancher down the road that doesn't hunt, they think we're idiots. They classify all of us as idiots because they see somebody sticking a weapon out the window. And it's affecting our access, and it's costing the state of Kansas money because they're not selling hunting licenses because the guys quit hunting because they no longer can get in there and hunt. We realized leasing was part of the problem because, you know, non-resident stuff come in and hunted. But the next biggest problem that we're having is landowner access because of the illegal hunting that's going on. It's a negative view the public has on us, and it's affecting all of us, and it's affecting the state of Kansas. It's affecting this department right here. One thing I would just like to read just shortly here, it comes directly from Minnesota, and they put it better than I ever could, and I just want to kind of just refer to it real quick. This is the Uncased Firearms Report. Basically, this states statistical data was gathered from the International Hunter Education Hunter Incident Clearinghouse and State Hunter Education Sections relating to the firearms accidents that occurred in or around motor vehicles. The data set was used for a 10-year period from 98 to 2007. If the law was modified, and this was the states looking at their own case law to say, hey, are we doing the right thing? If the law was modified, they said, to allow uncased firearms and motor vehicles, there is a substantial statistical evidence that this change will greatly increase the incidence of accidental firearms related to injury and death of hunters in and around motor vehicles. Statistical data for 1 year was gathered from the Minnesota State Court System to evaluate state, county, and local law enforcement agencies' utilization of the current statute. Data clearly indicates that state, county, and local law enforcement agencies rely on the current statute as a law enforcement tool and as a method of providing for officer safety. If this law is modified to allow for uncased firearms in motor vehicles, those cities and counties who have a need to control firearms and are concerned for public safety and officer safety will enact local ordinances and regulations that will create disjointed requirements. The possible result would create confusion. Historical information gathered clearly indicates that using a motor vehicle as a means or platform for hunting is not considered fair chase by the general public and therefore is perceived as an unethical means of hunting and poaching. That is what the public thinks of us when they see this type of activity. And that is why when our good, legitimate hunters out there can't find a place to hunt, they throw their arms up, they don't buy your hunting license, and they just quit because they're frustrated. So that's part of the access part. But, you know, it's something that I think is long coming. The case, having uncased weapons out there, loaded weapons going down the road, is the core problem that Kansas is having, road hunting, poaching, the whole nine yards. All these guys are doing that. Let's give the game wardens another tool, our law enforcement officers another tool to pull that vehicle over and check them. Some states have said under gun case law that if you cannot access the weapon within the cab, you have to actually exit the cab, which means they're putting their gun in a case, either putting it behind the seat, putting it in the bed of the truck, or putting it in the trunk, that it is a good system. The other part they look at boats, ATVs, and those other airplanes. They want you to actually put a trigger lock system on there, a gun case and a trigger lock system, if you do have no place for storage that is not accessible to you. So, and the trigger lock systems are by code, usually three digits, or a key. I have members right now that currently that do that, because they have young kids and that type of stuff and are conscious about safety. Everything that we teach, that people teach in hunter safety, goes against what we allow in the state of Kansas by allowing guys with loaded weapons on the vehicle. Even if they do have permission, it doesn't matter, it's not safe. I would like just to hit just a couple little points here. I wanted to bring up again spotlighting with you. You mentioned something about the state of Kansas tried to get rid of the spotlighting, allowing spotlighting, and you said something to do with the Kansas Constitution. There was a problem.
There's actually a court case from the late 90s related to recreational spotlighting. And spotlighting needs to be prohibited just in general. And there was a case that went to the Kansas Supreme Court on a motion to dismiss. And as to the constitutionality of the statute, which is why we have the statute today, which permits recreational spotlighting. It has a couple exceptions, landowners on their own land, and essentially as long as you don't have a firearm in your possession, generally speaking.
So you could not get rid of the recreational part of that?
I don't think that you can do it.
Okay, because other states that I've lived and hunted in do not allow spotlighting. Some of them do, that do have spotlighting, do not allow spotlighting during the hunting season. Some of them limit hours of operation where they shut it down at 10, 11 o'clock at night. Problem is, we're burning up resources for our wildlife and parks guys are out there getting nuisance calls because nobody knows whether the guy's got a weapon in his vehicle or not. So everybody thinks that everybody's a poacher, and so they're picking up the phone, and they're my game warden is, with them only working 40 hours a week now, he's out there burning up his time when it's a nuisance call, which I realize he's doing his job. But it'd be something if we can somehow look at it and try to limit it one way or the other. I think it would help those guys out, and it would give our landowners a little bit of sense of security with their property, because the landowners also look at these guys as in a negative manner, and they also classify, even though they're not hunters to me and not hunters to anybody in this room, I'm sure, but they classify all of us in that category, which again affects our access to land to hunt. Just want to double check my notes here real quick. The other thing they mentioned up in the Minnesota was on that case law was, you know, when the officers, just general officers, not game wardens, but just general officers, they use that gun case law, all of them do effectively, and they've stopped other crimes when it comes to domestic violence issues, other crimes, in which I never thought about it until I read this law, that these guys, that it actually deterred other crimes in the community, shooting signs, even guys that were out fishing that had their weapons in there, it led up to other things, because these guys were breaking that wall, one law, and so it just led on to the next thing. And so they really, they took it to heart. They were really serious up there in Minnesota when they said, we're looking at maybe getting rid of the gun case law. And they were up in arms about it because they really think it's an important tool that makes a difference in their state.
All right.
Just if I could finish up one thing and then I'll get off of here. I just want everybody to know that me being with Quality Deer Management Association, I realize we're new to the state of Kansas. A lot of people do not realize the achievements of the Quality Deer Management Association, but I just want to hit a few real quick that we did this year. And for the first time ever, the Career Achievement Award from the Wildlife Society has never been before awarded to a conservation organization. We're the first organization to ever get that award. The other thing is 2011 Budweiser Outdoors Conservationist of the Year was awarded to our founder, Joe Hamilton. And the next thing we have going on this year is our CEO, Brian Murphy, is up for the most influential person in the outdoors by Outdoor Life. So I just want to let you all know a little bit of background on what we're out there doing. So I appreciate your comments and everything. Chris, I appreciate your comments. And if anybody has any questions for me, I'd be more than happy to answer them.
Chris, I have a question for you. At the beginning of Tim's conversation here, you mentioned there was a group 4 years ago that has to be negotiated with for, can you rephrase that real quickly? I didn't catch that.
It was the position of the Kansas County Attorney and District Attorney Association, I think is the acronym, that when there was a bill proposed by the Wildlife Federation that had mandatory minimum penalties in it, and those penalties, as that bill went through the process, those penalties were the sticking point, the mandatory minimums, between getting that bill out of committee and through the House and Senate. And so as a result, the Wildlife Federation acquiesced to the position of the District Attorneys Association and basically said, okay, no mandatory minimums for first-time offenders. There are mandatory minimums for second and third offenses in our statutes.
What Wildlife Federation? What are you talking
about? The Kansas Wildlife Federation. Steve Sorensen, I think, is here. I've seen him.
Okay, it's a Kansas.
Over there.
Okay. So you're saying that if anything was initiated from Wildlife and Parks, we would negotiate. How? What would you just present that to the appropriate committee or?
what would happen is if it was determined that the department was going to push forward on a legislative issue such as this, or if Tim got a sponsor, which I'm sure he has a sponsor for his legislation already, to get a bill introduced, you have to have a sponsor. And so when the bill would be drafted and they would have a hearing on it, and then they lay off after a hearing for another meeting, and then they'll have a discussion on it, at which time they call it working the bill. And if they work the bill and send it out of committee, I'm sure that this issue will be a sticking point. And one side or the other is going to get their way. There's no in-between in this issue when you have a mandatory minimum sentence.
Chris, let me ask this. Maybe it's a little to clear it up for me, I suppose. If we took an action as a commission here, really wouldn't have any teeth because the legislature has to approve it. Is that correct?
The items that Tim's discussing are legislative in nature.
Okay, so us taking action as a commission,
you still have to get the legislature to enact the penalties. The legislature sets the penalties for crimes, and so you still have to get the legislature to enact the provisions that Tim's talking about.
But can Kansas Department of Wildlife and Parks introduce it to the legislature, or does it have to be an individual?
No, the department could do it.
Would you be willing to do that? Review it, have work sessions, you guys all talk about it, figure it out. The sportsmen's thing, I'll give you the honest truth, sportsmen's think, and I'm talking about the whole system, not individuals, sportsmen's general consensus of Kansas Department of Wildlife and Parks is we're sitting on our hands, collecting the check, and we're doing nothing. Because they're frustrated with the system. You know, I don't like to see a system like it going on. I don't like to see negativism. I like to see positive growth, positive movement. That's what I'm all about. I don't agree with those statements. But you know, that's what general public thinks. They really do. Because they're frustrated and they throw their arms up. It's like nobody cares. That's what they think. So, I have nothing against anybody. But that's what they think generally out there. And I'm sure maybe some of you have heard those comments before. I don't know. But you know, I'm here to try to make a difference, move forward, and
well, I understand, and I might comment that at least in the case of Frank and I over the years, you can take all of our checks and you couldn't buy a shotgun.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I think we had to take a pay cut, and I think we're down to $30 a meeting, and I'll get a 1099, so it's not like we're getting a lot of money. The problem with this, and I understand, and we all hate poaching, we all hate road hunting, and we'd like to have all these initiatives, but they're not going to be as popular as you might think. Judicial discretion and prosecutorial discretion is a sacred thing, and you get away from a group of active sportsmen and you start saying we want to take away the judge's discretion to go light on first-time offenders or go heavy on first-time offenders, you start reaching a lot of items that are sacred, and it's going to be difficult to do it. And while it is yet to be proven that higher fines actually prevent more poaching, I mean, it kind of makes you feel good, and I don't have a problem with it. So, but I think we're asking for that. I don't know how to respond to all your issues because some of them are going to be difficult to get across. The case law, I'd like for you to talk to any farmer about whether or not his 243 that he shoots coyotes with and deer with, if he thinks he has to have it cased in the back of the trunk or the back of his truck. This is not going to be so popular. Now, among sportsmen, we can understand the logic and we can understand why other states do it, but you try to go up to Topeka and get this pushed across and get the people who generally, there are a lot of elected officials that don't think that Wildlife Park sets on their hands. They think they meddle in our agriculture affairs too much. And so you're going to have some blowback with some of these things. And I think we have to be careful and pick and choose our battles. Mm-hmm. And not have a large bill that we're going to push through that we're going to lose. Let's try to pick those that we can win. And I don't know, we can maybe think a little more about it, but while it sounds good, it's not going to be as easy as one thinks to get some of this passed.
Tim, I took a look at the stuff that you gave me at the last meeting, and I've, you know, been active on your emails, looking at the items, and I boiled down your stuff to five main parts, really, five main legislative parts. And honestly, I think that there's one that really has a good chance of passing that we could get passed. The rest of them, I think, are going to be a real tough battle or unachievable. Mm-hmm. So I'm not trying to dissuade you, but I'm trying to give you an honest assessment of the legislative agenda. And I'll talk about the legislative agenda, and you're going to see there's a bunch of big players this year, and we'll be lucky to get any time.
Sure, and I understand that. I understand there's a lot of stuff in the state. I recently had two landowners that are cow-calf operators, have, you know, not huge. They've got a couple thousand acres, but neither one of them carry weapons with them when they're out checking cows. They care less. If they see one, they run back to the house. I had one recently, had eight coyotes on a cow brought down last week. Run back to the house, got the weapon by the time it was done. First thing they did, they picked up the phone, and they called somebody that knows an avid coyote hunter, knows what they're doing, and that person's up there taking care of the problem for them. And that's where I think we need to get our message across to our landowners is we've already got people in place. You just need to know those contacts. We can call them up on the phone and say, hey, he's having a problem with the coyotes. Shooting one coyote on your property isn't going to take care of that problem. With running around with a weapon and you shoot one every once in a while, it's avidly being out there calling, trapping, those type of activities with the professionals. They're the guys that are going to get the job done for the landowners out there. Where that landowner run with the rifle, he's going to get that one coyote every once in a great while, but he hasn't taken care of the problem. Just, I know I'm running out of time. I just wanted to headline my issues I had this year on my property, next to my property here in my rotisserie. I had two dead does shot, which I referred to last 50 yards from my house, found dead, left a leg. I had two guys, next day I found those does, I had two guys shooting doves off the road in towards my house. I had one trespasser with a rifle, neighboring landowner, hunter, on the ground, in the grass, hunter with a rifle, 2 days after Thanksgiving, 40 yards from him, has no clue he's there. The guy coughs so he doesn't get shot, because he wants to kind of spook him off, he's afraid he's going to get killed. The guy runs, tries to jump across the fence, gets hung up, whatever. But the guy's got a mask on. This is a question for Chris. Guy's got a mask on. This guy's repeated 3 years in a row, three times, illegal deer, trespassing, the whole nine yards. What are our legal rights? Can we bring this guy down? Can we tackle him? Can we physically bring him to the ground? He's got a weapon on our property. He's trespassing. What are our legal rights as an owner, landowner?
Right. First off, I can't give you personal legal advice. Because that's where we're at.
You know?
I'm not going to.
We're playing games here, and everybody's tired of it.
Isn't this perhaps more of the local law enforcement rather than wildlife and parks issues, though?
It's a hunter. Yeah.
Cool, sure.
Tim, I just want to give you one piece of advice.
Absolutely.
Take a smaller bite from the sandwich, and maybe you'll have some success. I know these are all important issues, and they're all important issues to everybody. And it probably has happened, some or all these issues have probably happened to all of us sportsmen in a room at one time or another.
Sure.
But in the world we live in, and you referred to the gun case law, and you thought the NRA voiced their opinion on how good Minnesota's is. When Minnesota gets that gun case law before them and they start really talking about it, the NRA is going to bring 5,000 people there and oppose it.
Sure. And I support the NRA. So, I don't have a problem with the NRA. I support everything they do.
Yeah, but they're not going to support you.
I don't know.
That's where I'm going with the NRA.
I have nothing bad to say about it.
You're trying to let. If we can focus on one issue and help you accomplish it, we'd love to do that.
Yeah, one issue is better than none.
Okay,
that's all I have to say. Thank you,
Chris. Just so my understanding, this department would have to take a position, and Mr. Chairman, whoever can jump in here. We would have to take a department on increasing fines or mandatory fines or something of that nature, most likely, in order for it to go anywhere in the legislature. Is that a fair statement?
I think if the commission takes a position, or the department, for example, on mandatory minimums, that it's not going to make any difference.
Okay.
I think that the lobby and the position of the Kansas County Attorney and District Attorney Association on that issue is not going to be overcome, based on my previous experience in the legislature. And so, it's not just our issue. There are other people who've proposed mandatory minimums over time on a lot of things. And unless there's a huge groundswell from the public, and I mean huge, and I'm talking, where do we have mandatory minimums? DUI, right? Something that is statewide, far-ranging, that affects not just hunters, but it affects every citizen of the state, then you're going to see something like a mandatory minimum. You're going to see the tide shift, and that position's going to be overcome. On this issue, I don't see it happening.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Is there any other comments? Thank you. Is there anybody else who would like to address the commission?
KVO Radio. I'm also with the Kansas Wildlife Federation and various other conservation groups. I do want to thank Tim for presenting this, and more than that, I want to thank the commission for listening to this. I know it's going to be a big step, but we got to take that first step. I'm more into youth and family programs now, even though I've been a hunter education instructor for 15 years. This week, we just did the Clint Boyer Youth and Deer Management Hunt. You can't believe the stories that families tell me when they're out in the woods with their kids of the shells, the shots that's going through the woods. So, you know, I reported that we did a survey on the radio. It ended up 444 to 66 in favor of stiffening fines. So this might be the public voice you want to hear, Chris. I don't know. But I did want to report that. I had a little deal on the radio trying to compare statistics with a woman in a bikini. I won't go there because I fluffed it up bad on the radio. So you know statistics can be bad, and you can form them and shape them. But I did a follow-up survey just to see what people thought. On the original one, we had just 66 people voice an opinion. On the last one, we had 175 people voice their opinion. And the question I asked was, why are you opposed to stiffening fines and penalties? But one thing that come to light, you know, we think about road hunting in Kansas as being a tradition. We've always done it. That was the very least reason some people accepted. So it's just something to think about. Thank you for your time. Well, by the way, I have talked with several legislators. They're willing to listen. I have had a meeting with Mark Goodman, who was the prosecuting attorney when Bo Arndt got shot. He is willing to listen and go to his organization and see what we can do. I have talked with Mike Beam with the Kansas Livestock Association. He's willing to listen. So really, let's take this first step.
Okay. Is there somebody else?
I'm Charlie Stevens from Downs, and I just wanted to say thank you for our new CO. He's been up there just a few months, and he's made a tremendous difference. As a landowner, it's been great. We don't have the road hunting, we don't have the poaching, it's been wonderful, and I just wanted to say thank you.
Good. What's his name?
Landon Cleveland.
Does anybody else have anything they'd like to present to the commission or have their voices heard?
Non-agenda, right?
Non-agenda. Well, all right. Let's start on the agenda. Secretary's remarks. Who's going to do that today?
Mr. Chairman, the secretary is not available today, and basically, in general, because the governor hasn't come out with his budget, which will be next Wednesday night, the state of the state, and then we'll have the budget Thursday morning. So essentially we have no report, other than I did read the other day that state revenue is up a little bit, so tax collections are up, so that's gonna bode well for the state in general.
Okay. Well, then that would mean that you're up on the legislature.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, the legislature is about to start up. Monday will be the first day of the new legislative session, or of the new session this year, and we're in a two-year cycle. This is the second year of a second-year cycle, of the two-year cycle, and so bills that were introduced last year that didn't see action could potentially see action this year. They have to be out of the House of Origin by turnaround, but in general, there's only a couple bills out there that I think probably will see action from last year, but I'll cover what we have from last year before I go into this year. Senate Bill 120 last year was related to the vessel titling, and might hear some scuttle about vessel titling here and there. I'm not sure that the bill's actually going to move this year. We'll just have to wait and see. It did pass out of one house, and it passed out of the Senate. It's into the House, and didn't get a hearing in the House that I know of, and so it's just going to stay. Senate Bill 123 was a bill that passed last year and was signed by the governor, and it relates to how we set fees for cabins, and you guys have experienced that already. Senate Bill 152 passed last year, and it allowed people with concealed carry permits to carry those concealed carry firearms during hunting anytime. And it also had a provision in there related to the use of suppressors while hunting. If you recall that bill, the proposal came to the commission, and ultimately both on suppressors for use for animal damage control, and then allowing concealed carry permit holders to use concealed carry or use those firearms, carry those firearms, and ultimately some other entity introduced that bill and got it through the legislature. House Bill 2013 relates to the sale and purchase of firearms, and that was a bill that passed last year. And the only reason I'm bringing that up again is the old law used to be that you couldn't purchase a firearm from any state that wasn't a contiguous state to Kansas, related back to 1968 Gun Control Act and some laws that were passed in Kansas in 1970. And those provisions of the federal law were repealed in 1986, and Kansas law never kept up with that. Now, as a citizen of the state of Kansas, you can go purchase a long gun, which would be a shotgun or a rifle, in any state as long as it's okay with their laws. House Bill 2089 related to trespass, essentially retrieving dogs from posted land, allowing owners to retrieve their hunting dog from posted land. The bill didn't get a hearing at all. House Bill 2152 related to boating under the influence, and it would have increased the penalties for boating under the influence. The bill had a hearing, passed out of committee, and was routed back to another committee, which tells me that's probably not going anywhere. House Bill 2168 would have given free park entrance to all veterans. The bill had a hearing, but it didn't go anywhere. House Bill 2295, if I see any action this year out of any of the old bills, I think this is probably the bill, and it relates to deer. And as you know, deer is a very controversial topic in the legislature. It basically made some changes as to who qualifies for permits, made some mandatory changes to deer seasons, adding 60 days at the end of our deer season, and has a provision in there related to crossbows. That bill, we had a hearing last year. It went to a subcommittee. We had a subcommittee hearing. And basically, as it came out of there, the secretary and I were in the discussion with the legislators. And, you know, they're anxiously waiting to see what we do this year. Let's put it that way. So I think if we see any action out of old bills in the legislature, that's probably the one that we'll do. We'll have action on. House Bill 2398 amends the definition of feral swine and increases the penalty for importing or possessing feral swine. That came in late in the session, didn't get any action. And then House Concurrent Resolution 5017 relates to boats and vessel and taxation. And I'll talk a little bit more about this because it's going to be on our legislative agenda this year. A House concurrent resolution to amend the Constitution to change the watercraft taxation level in the state of Kansas. The citizens are going to have to amend the Constitution. So the process is that the concurrent resolution passes out of both houses and then goes to the voters in November on the general ballot, is what it'll probably be set for. And if the voters of the state of Kansas vote to amend the Constitution to set a different watercraft taxation level, then it goes back to the legislature the following year, and they can set a different level of taxation. This amendment has happened before in relation to cars. Cars used to be taxed at the level that boats are at now, and RVs. And it happened once before, or it did pass out of the House and the Senate back in, I think, 2000. But it also included aircraft. So generally speaking, this House concurrent resolution is passed out of the House. It's in the Senate, and I think we'll see where it goes this year. I'm hopeful that it would provide some relief to vessel owners in the state. Also, there are some arguments that if you lower the taxation value of watercraft, people would buy newer watercraft, and they also wouldn't take them out of state to register them to avoid personal property tax. And then finally, last year, Executive Reorganization Order 36, which created the department, which is also going to be a topic for the legislature this year. When I was talking to Tim earlier about the package for this year, there are a number of major sweeping changes being proposed in the legislature this year, not by our department. I'm talking on a grand scale. Number one is the budget, just to enhance stability to the budget. Number two, tax reform. And I think the governor's proposal will be out Wednesday. There's been a lot of talk about tax reform. CAPERS reform, state employee retirement system reform. There was a committee that met. And all of these items that I'm talking about in amongst themselves probably could eat up an entire legislative session, and they're all being proposed at one time. Medicaid reform, water law reform, school finance formula reform, and then to throw everything else into the mix, redistricting. So redistricting of all the political boundaries within the state. And then there's also, and we talked, Tim asked the question about having a judicial prosecutor and a court system designed only for wildlife and parks. There's also a judicial reform process that's ongoing, and talking about consolidation of judicial districts and reducing the number of judges. So all of that we have going on, and then the stuff that we'd like to see. So it's going to be a big year. First item is the recodification of the agency, and hopefully that will be a technical bill, but it can be amended as it goes through the process, basically changing the name and taking the duties for tourism and putting them into what were the wildlife and parks statutes, which will now be wildlife, parks, and tourism. I have a draft of that bill, and it's a couple hundred pages, so it's a long bill, it's a very technical bill. But it's something we have to get done. It's very important for the department. I talked about the constitutional amendment on boat taxes, and now I'm talking about our proposals for this coming year. The constitutional amendment on boat taxes, the department is going to support it. Last year, we just sat back and watched the process and saw how it was working. Hopefully, we can get it out of the Senate. At the same time, there's a cap on, by regulation, we set the boat registration fees within a cap in the statute, just like hunting and fishing fees and deer permits and all of those are capped at a certain level. Well, it's been a number of years, but we reached the cap on the boating side. Not that the department's proposing to raise the registration, but the cap, just for future planning, needs to be raised at some point, and this seems like a decent time to do it. Depending on what the governor proposes, we had talked about a tax credit for, it depends on his tax proposal, which we have not seen, but a tax credit for processors to process antlerless deer who donate that value of that deer. They could get a tax credit for that donation of their labor, for example, for Hunters Feeding the Hungry. Again, that's going to be completely dependent on what the governor's proposal is. And then the department is proposing to discontinue exemptions for seniors on the hunting and fishing side for hunting and fishing licenses. And I think that that covers the wildlife side. On the park side, there is a park pass. We'd like to change the way that park passes are done, annual passes for residents, and allow them to get a park pass when they renew their vehicle plates, and they would expire when their plates expire. A similar system's in place in Michigan, and it's estimated if we got 10% of vehicles to purchase a park pass at that time, residents, we would double what we take in just having a gate system that's completely dependent on the weather, whether people are not will come or not. At the same time, and there's still some talk about what the fee is going to be set at that level, but it would be a reduction from what we're at now. At the same time, we would propose to discontinue 65 and disabled reduced park fees. Primarily, there's no way to keep ages on. Ages are not corresponding with the license plates. We don't know about whose age is what. Everybody would pay the same fee. And then the last thing that the department would be proposing is to change the alcohol laws related to KDWPT property. Currently, it's 3.2. By state statute, there are a few exceptions if somebody lives in a state-owned house or the governor's mansion or things like that. But we would say that you could have alcohol on KDWPT property subject to regulation. So we could close properties like we do now. We have some that are close to 3.2. So, and with that, I'll stand for any questions.
Chris, you talked about one bill that had some junk deer proposals involved, an extra 60 days of antlerless season, so on and so forth. Are there any other features besides that and the first of many crossbow injections? Is there any other features in that would affect deer hunters or that are significant?
I think that the major one is probably that has any sort of steam is crossbows or some sort of extended mandatory seasons.
Anybody have any questions of Chris?
I have one, Mr. Chairman. Chris, I missed what you said about, what was the deal about the exemption on hunting and fishing licenses? Was it?
The department is proposing to remove any sort of exemption for seniors. 65 and older currently are exempt from a hunting and fishing license. They don't have to pay for a hunting and fishing license.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, we had an individual talking to us about crossbows, and I, going through all the information, I would favor allowing crossbows in the bow season from like 70 years of age on up. That I would, you know, right now I'd oppose anything like younger than that. But I can see at 70 you start losing a little bit of your arm strength and stuff to pull one, and it.
I think that, Mr. Chairman, if I could respond, I think that that's going to be a topic for discussion with Lloyd this afternoon. Okay. I mean, two separate issues, whether there's a crossbow mandate from the legislature versus what I think Lloyd's going to discuss some items tonight or this afternoon for you.
Chris, yeah. These items are, that you give us that are in front of the legislature, do those come from us as a commission or from internally from Wildlife and Parks or from some legislative action?
Okay. So the department's legislative proposal at this point is all internal. It's, or, you know, that in, it's just like any idea or any regulatory idea or legislative idea can come to the department or the commission and essentially filter somehow through, and somebody ultimately makes a decision, which would be the secretary, as to what the policy or the legislation that we're going to pursue as a department. Now, in the past, some commissioners have proposed legislation and or requested that the department pursue some legislation, and we've done so. So there's no hard and fast rule as to how legislation comes about that the department supports it, but ultimately the secretary has to give his blessing to it, and that's what you're going to, that's ultimately how we would end up pursuing something. Is there an item in particular that you're interested in?
No.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I have a question. Chris, why would the legislature, why or how would they be involved with Crossbow?
It's going to be a little bit of a lengthy answer, but in a nutshell, there's been increasing pressure over the last 10 years to allow the use of crossbows in the legislature. I don't know that and people have come to the commission and discussed it. I think Mr. Woods here in the audience over there. But just like anything, anybody can, if they don't get satisfaction at the commission or the department level, can request that their legislator introduce a bill. And this is one that I've seen repetitiously for the last three or four sessions. It's starting to build a little steam, so to speak. Ultimately, I don't know where that takes it, but as you sit here as a commission and say there's a bill out there, and I'll use one example, which was suppressors last year. There was a request to use suppressors just in general or concealed carry. And the commission looked at it and took no action on it, on the concealed carry, on the suppressor, started to take action on animal damage control. And that wasn't fast enough for some people. They didn't want to wait another year. So last year when the legislature came back, the bill was introduced and it passed. And obviously, any sort of legislative mandate takes away from the discretion of the department or the commission. And those are the options that you have to weigh when you balance requests versus whether you think somebody can get something through the legislature.
The legislature can basically do what they want to do. The commission, we have certain things that the commission has the authority to do through regulation, which takes a lot longer because we're not an elected body. But there is no limit to what sometimes we may consider meddling and stuff that our agency may know best, and there just isn't anything we can do about it.
Except the Constitution is a limit.
Hierarchy
of laws in general, Constitution, statutes, regulations, the legislature passes those statutes, and the commission has to work within those statutes. So that's how you end up with a statutory mandate that the commission or the department's discretion is taken away.
When it affects our agency negatively or against the wishes of the secretary and the commission, I don't like it, but there's just sometimes nothing we can do. You have something.
I had a question for Chris regarding the senior exemptions. Do you have the current data on how much Dingell Johnson and Pittman Robertson money is worth foregoing by exempting seniors?
It's a difficult question. Obviously, I think the proposal is based around the concept that more and more people are becoming exempt, current hunters and anglers, and you not only lose the license revenue, you lose Dingell Johnson or PR money, right? I don't have a number for you because it's difficult to ascertain that when we've only had an electronic system for 5 years and people don't have to have a license. So I don't know who's actually hunting and fishing or what's being lost. All I know is that the burden is increasing on those who are continuing to pay into the system.
If my memory serves me right, the last numbers I saw, which was probably 5 or 6 years ago, was around $8 per hunting and fishing
license. No, it's more than that now.
And
it's about, that's what we would recoup. It's about $12, is that, if that's what your question was. The last time I saw some figures.
Then multiplied by all the baby boomers that are
right.
Becoming.
You know, if you look long-term at the health of the department, that's really what the issue boils down to. 2 or 3 years from now, we're, our number base is not going to be as declining as it is going to be in 8 to 10 years when, you know, people my parents' age have aged into that. So,
be prepared for emails.
Chris, I've got one more question. I'm trying to think of how to phrase it, I guess. I'm a little slow here. Is there any legal reason that we have a mandatory age, maximum age for a type of weapon, or a mandatory minimum age for a type of weapon that we use?
Not that I know of.
So we could set an age, maximum age, minimum age, if we wanted to?
Right.
Okay.
One comment about that, if it doesn't conflict with state law. I mean, you can't have little kids hunting with a handgun if they can't own one. I mean, it would be hard. I mean, they'd have to have somebody with them or something. So if it conflicts state law, there may be something there. But.
Mr. Pierce.
Yeah, Chris, I've got a question. Doug asked two of them. Thanks. Will there be certain ages be grandfathered in if you change to the 65 and over? I mean, like the guy that's 83 isn't going to have to back up. Is he going to have to back up, you know, start paying again, or?
The current proposal is no.
Well, no which way? No.
No grandfather.
No grandfather. Okay. And these are things that you will be asking of the legislature this year?
That's correct.
Okay, when might these things go into effect?
Well,
I realize you can't say, you know, it depends on how it goes, but.
Realize also that there's a long way from what you start with to what you end with.
Right.
The legislature is a lengthy process. But, you know, the park pass, we were hoping to look at July 1, for example, to implement.
This year.
So it doesn't really in that case, it doesn't really matter when you implement it. You're going to have a phase-in period of some time where people are going to be either in the system or out of the system, depending on when their license, when you would normally purchase a calendar year park permit versus when you get your license plates, for example. So that one, we're hoping July 1, the alcohol on state property, January 1, just because it's, we don't want to make a change the primary impact on those parks. The boat tax issue would be go to vote in November, presumably. The cap on registration would be January 1. And I think probably the discontinuance of the exemption would probably be January 1. I don't know that we've set and I don't have a draft of the bill yet. So, but I would guess January 1. Just because we would be into, we're into efficiencies.
Will you sometime be able to provide more information about percentages of sportsmen that are currently exempt?
Well, 60? We hope so, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, that would help tremendously.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thanks, Chris.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to comment that the legislature represents us too. And if we want to talk to them, they are getting paid to listen to us. So if there comes up some bill that is against what we as sportsmen and campers and tourist people have interest in tourism, go up and visit with them and explain to them, because there's been twice in my, and I've talked to a lot of legislators, but they'll say, well, you know, Frank, you're the only person that said you're in favor of this bill. So that makes it 100% of the people I've talked to me are in favor of it. So go talk to them. Let them know. And let them represent us as well.
I'd like to add to that discussion, too. One of the things, when you talk about legislature versus the commission, a lot of times what I've seen happen in the last few years, someone will bring a point to us, and we depend on the expertise of the department to research some of the points that are presented to us. And while we're waiting on that, it's not an answer. I think a lot of times when people come to us, they want an answer right then and there. And we can't do that. We have to research it, and we have to make sure it's sound biologically. Is it sound for what we're trying to do for our mission of the department? So I think when we, and I've noticed that people that have presented didn't get the answer right away, then they go to the legislature. And that does take it out of our hands. And the suppressor's point was that very thing. We get it presented to us. We don't have a chance to even research it, and all of a sudden it's in the legislature, which was a surprise. But I think sometimes understanding the process that we have to go through before you're dissatisfied with our answers, just kind of work with us before you take it to the legislature.
Okay, anybody else? Any more comments from the public? Thank you, Mr. Tyveson.
Thank you.
Okay, let's move to the commissioner permit update and drawing.
Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, we're going to draw for commissioner permits before this session's over here, but first I'm going to give you just a little bit of background on the commissioner permit program. Then Jared McJunkin with the National Wild Turkey Federation is going to do a little presentation on how some of these funds have been spent. And I think the Turkey Federation is going to make a short presentation, and then we will draw for the permits. And this will actually be the seventh drawing we've held. For some of you that may not be completely familiar with this program, in 2006, we did the first drawing for Commissioner Big Game permits. The statute allows for one elk or one antelope or up to seven deer permits for a total of seven Big Game Commissioner permits that can be issued. Nonprofit conservation organizations that are operating or based in Kansas that actively promote the hunting and fishing heritage are eligible to apply for these permits. If they are selected for one of these permits, and what we'll do is when they apply, they select either an elk, a deer, or antelope, and it's first come, first serve, since there's only one elk and one antelope. When they receive this permit, they can then auction it, raffle it, sell it, however they want in a fundraising effort. When they sell that permit, the price of the permit is then subtracted out. 85% of that fund comes back to the agency. 15% stays with that chapter organization. They can spend that at their discretion. And then that 85%, once a project or program that is approved by the department is agreed upon, that money goes back to that organization to complete that project. That first year, we had 59 organizations apply. Those seven permits sold for a whopping $49,000. The elk permit sold for a big price that year. Since then, we've probably averaged around 100 applications a year. And the sales were a little bit slow there for a while. And I think in 2007, I think it was only about $27,000. In 2009, they sold for almost $35,000. So we're averaging about 100 applications. The permit, I think the groups are learning how to market these. They're learning what groups to go try to sell these permits to. And I think it's been pretty successful. And I think we'll learn a little bit more about these funds when Jared comes up and talks. I think last year we had the permit sold for $41,700, and that brought $33,000 to the department that then was reissued back to these organizations to complete, you know, mutually approved projects and conservation programs. We had 98 eligible applications this year. And I will say, too, that a chapter organization is only eligible to receive one of these permits once out of every 3 years. So, but multiple chapters of one organization are eligible, and you'll see that when we start doing the drawing. So we had 98 eligible applications received. They're in the hopper, each with a number, and we'll draw those out once we're done with the presentation. So if there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. If not, I'll turn it over to Jared to give his little presentation. If we can get the PowerPoint up.
See if we can get this running here. Just stand there with you. Can we slide it to the left? Would that help?
No.
Any better? Just a different PowerPoint, though. Might be tough to read. I'll wing it. Hey, Mike, I think if we go left, you can maybe get it out of the shadow, or maybe not. Yeah, keep going. It's going to be tough for you guys to see it, but. That'll work. Thanks, Mike. Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, first of all, thanks for letting me have this opportunity to tell you a little bit about the Turkey Federation, and I won't take a lot of your time, but for those of you who aren't familiar with the Turkey Federation, I did want to just give you a brief overview of who we are. Our mission is dedicated to the conservation of the wild turkey and preservation of our hunting heritage. We have about 2,100 chapters nationwide. We have about 235,000 members nationwide. Here in Kansas, we have about 33 chapters and 2,800 members. We've been working with KDWPT now for a long time through the name changes, and we actively manage and conserve upland habitats in the state of Kansas. And the other half of our mission that is very important to us is to promoting our hunting heritage. On the national level, we've been a strong proponent of families of field legislation, which some of you probably know has been passed in over 32 states, and almost 600,000 new members. That's something we're pretty proud of being a part of. We've invested over $2.1 million in the 4-H shooting sports program and almost $500,000 in the National Archery in the Schools program. And we've also been a strong proponent of Farm Bill legislation and conservation policy. And on a national level, we've invested over $372 million conserving 17 million acres of habitat, and not just for wild turkeys and upland game, but also for the non-game species that use those same habitats. We're a grassroots organization. We have fundraising banquets, which we'll actually have our state awards banquet this weekend, and then we'll start the full year of a lot of banquets. We have a lot of different programs, but some of our strongest programs are our outreach programs. And again, that's our Jakes as our youth program, Women in the Outdoors, and our Wheeling Sportsman's program. We're pretty fortunate here in Kansas. We have quite a few staff. We've kind of got a little Western field office going. Brandon Houck, who many of you know, is here. He is our director of conservation operations. Myself, I'm the conservation field supervisor. We have two regional directors. We just had Ellen Bennett, who some of you may have known, retire, and we're filling that position. And then we have Barry Woods out west. But again, focusing on this meeting and this commission and our relationship with Kansas Department of Wildlife and Parks, we've had a strong partnership with this agency. Mike Minchner and Jim Pittman have been our tech reps and their predecessor before. And our funding works on what we call Hunting Heritage Superfund. So the money that we raise at our banquets comes back to our local chapters through our state superfund. And our technical representatives, Jim and Mike, sign off on every dollar we spend in the state. And we think that's a good system because it makes sure we're spending things that we're working on mutually beneficial goals. And since 1985, we've invested $885,000 in the state of Kansas and improved over 6,600 acres. Can't see the picture there. That's actually a picture from one of the projects. We've done 55 different projects on Kansas Department of Wildlife and Parks and Tourism public wildlife areas or state fishing lakes for about $150,000. Another one that's real popular with the state board is the walk-in program. We've been a strong supporter of that, I think, for probably six years now, and invested over $38,000.
We understand that access is an important part of carrying on the hunting tradition. We've also spent $64,000 on 28 different habitat equipment purchases, and a lot of those are in partnership with this agency to do more habitat work. Oh, I skipped over that. We've done $183,000 worth of wild turkey research, and most of that's been in partnership with this agency. So on to this year, and we'll do a little check presentation here in a minute. Hopefully you guys can see this later, but this is the 15 projects that we've approved this year to fund in Kansas. And these are projects, there's a few others that aren't on here that we funded too, but these are projects that you guys were directly a partner with, archery in the schools, and as you see, a lot of habitat projects too. And a lot of partner dollars coming to the table, and that's from this agency, and we certainly support that and appreciate it. In addition to that money, we also are investing and budgeting over $20,000 for some of those youth and women out in the outdoors programs, youth scholarships, and things of that nature. So the commissioner's permits, as you can see, we have received several of them starting in 2007. And with that, I guess there's 2, 4, 6, 8 of those, we've raised almost $50,000. Last year, we did receive 2 permits, and I just want to show you the 3 projects we used those on were, again, for the support of the spring walk-in program, and this one in particular was working in the north central part of the state and kind of an incentive program to get that program increasing landowner sign-up in that area. $2,500 for a forest stand improvement project on Leavenworth State Fishing Lake, and $2,000 for a grassland restoration down on Big Hill Wildlife Area. Here's a picture of Brad. There's some pictures of the projects that we worked on. So again, I don't want to take a lot of your time, but I do want to thank you guys. These permits really help us. It helps us leverage our Superfund dollars to go farther, to do more work. We look forward to a lot of future projects with this agency. And I'd like to now ask Todd Adolph. He's our state chapter president for the state of Kansas to come up. And Mr. Chairman, if you would, we'd like to present you a check representative of those 15 projects that we partnered with the commission on. And again, I'll stand for any questions, but I certainly appreciate the support and the partnership. Thanks again.
How big is that check?
What's that?
How big is that check? Size what?
$57,950. I got caught reading.
For 19 is National Lobsters Federation Hayes. Long Beer Chapter, Big Creek Long Beers. And their choice was elk, so the elk is how long?
55.
Number
73 is Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation, Wichita. Their first choice was elk, so we'll go with their second choice, which is deer.
Okay.
There's 98 eligible, and because 101, you're confused. I'll just explain that there were six applications that were not eligible because they had one in the last 3 years. So that's why there's more than 98 numbers.
76.
76 is Ducks Unlimited Topeka. Their first choice was Elk, second choice was Antelope, so they will be awarded a third choice, which is Gator.
Third.
28. 28 is National Wild Turkey Federation, Iola. So that is the first Upland Pioneers chapter. Their first choice was elk, so they will be awarded a deer.
All right. It's 99. All right. Thank you. Linda, tourism briefing.
Good afternoon, commissioners and audience. Thank you for coming. Wanted to take just a minute before I start on the requested briefing with respect to our Kansas Flint Hills. Wanted to reiterate how important partnerships are to our tourism effort in the state of Kansas. One of our key and very greatly appreciated partners in this effort is Visit Salina. And Visit Salina is here and represented by Sylvia Rice. So I'd like to have Sylvia step up to the podium, please.
Good afternoon. Linda asked me to make a few comments, and they will just be a few comments. I'll start with, I do not have a $57,000 check for you. Apologize for that. I'll work on that in the future. I just wanted to say, first of all, I'll join President Lampkin and say welcome to Salina. We're very happy to have you here, both in this facility and in the community at large. I want to thank Commissioner Dill and also Sheila for giving us the opportunity to help host you today. We're excited to have you here. I really appreciate the definition that Commissioner Dill uses about your efforts and those things all about the outdoors, anything that has to do with the outdoors. We appreciate that here in Salina. In many facets of business, it's all about location. We really enjoy our location, which is being so close to the parks in Wilson, in Kerwin, in Kannapolis, in Milford, and others. This community benefits from that location. That, joined with the fact that we're on the two interstates, really does help boost our tourism efforts here. I want to thank Linda for asking me to just say hi. We're very excited, not just in Salina, but in the tourism industry as a whole, about the strengthening of our partnership with Wildlife and Parks, with the new department being formed. It's pretty obvious that the outdoors is our biggest asset when it comes to tourism in Kansas. We have many others as well. On a local level, the outdoors are important to us also. We have over 700 city parks acreage in here in Salina, and lots of facilities that we're awfully proud of, from baseball to soccer to softball to golf courses and all things in between, hiking, biking trails, and more to come in the future, we certainly are hoping. So that being said, I seriously just wanted to welcome you. Thank you for coming. Promise our partnership as we move ahead in the future. We also are anxious to hear about the state of the state next week, and all of that information to come, particularly with regard to the budget. The tourism folks that you've got in place in the department in Topeka are first notch, worked with them a long, long time. Worked with Linda for a long, long time as well. I think she's gonna give you a terrific report. She's given me just kind of a little bit of a peek at what that's gonna look like. When you talk about the great outdoors, we're also equally proud to be very closely located to the Flint Hills. I've told my staff we're gonna have to look at repositioning our branding as being X miles from Kansas' beautiful Flint Hills, because I think that that's gonna be that important to our efforts as we continue to market our assets here in Salina and Saline County to our visitors as well. So thank you.
Thanks, Linda.
Thank you, Sylvia. One of the things that the governor has reiterated time and time again, if I don't know if you've had the opportunity to talk to him, but is the ability for the Flint Hills to play a very vital role with respect to the economic impact of our state. The governor is very committed to this area and to this region and actually promoting this region as a travel destination to people on an international basis. One of the challenges that he has we face with respect to this is he has put this responsibility on the agency, which is a really good thing. We step up to it with a lot of pride and with a lot of excitement. The challenge that we face, however, is that no additional funding came along with the effort. So we are hoping that we'll see a little bit of a response with respect to that on the 11th when the governor addresses the state in the State of the State address. However, regardless, what we have been able to accomplish for those that did not have an opportunity to be a part of it, back in May, the governor held his first Flint Hills Visioning Summit. It was an economic summit designed to draw stakeholders from across the state and across the region and across the Flint Hills together to really talk about the issues that are facing the Flint Hills. We had a terrific turnout. It was an opportunity for stakeholder groups to come together that maybe had been on a regular basis at odds with each other. The only time you saw them, it was sort of like an oil and water relationship. You know, they come together on the issues that they disagreed about. I think everybody that attended that conference that was in Elmdale at Campwood YMCA was really impressed with the fact that the governor took time to spend the entire day with us. Since that time frame, there's been a lot of things that have been going on. There has been, as a result of the summit, we recognize the fact that we needed to work on some issues together. And so the governor encouraged us to form a Flint Hills work group. This Flint Hills work group is made up of landowners, individual landowners, of Kansas Livestock Association, of Farm Bureau, of trails organizations, which, by the way, Commissioner Meyer has been a very important part of. And I also want to mention the fact that Commissioner Dahl is a member of our Flint Hills work group as a landowner. The group has been charged with the responsibility of making sure that we address important issues. And what we did as a group came together initially and talked about the fact that we could easily sit there and argue about everything we disagreed about. But what we're charged to do is to really come together and find some common ground. The Tallgrass Prairie, as many of you guys realize, there's only 3% of the world's Tallgrass Prairie remaining in the world. That 3% happens to exist within the heartland of Kansas, within the Flint Hills of Kansas. So what the group decided to focus on was the fact that that is our common ground, and really to begin to identify areas that we could agree on, that we could come together and recognize. Some of the things that have happened that this group has been able to help pull off as a team since the May session is the fact that we have received as a team a $1.98 million grant that will allow us to work collectively and collaboratively to help plan the effort as we move forward. It is a planning grant. This planning grant is designed to actually get stakeholder improvement from the very beginning, grassroots involvement from all of the individuals that live across the Flint Hills. There will be a lot more coming out on that in the near future. But the cool thing with respect to this grant is not only did we receive a $1.98 million federal grant, we also were able to get this grant. We had to come up with about $500,000 in matching funds from partners. Within about 10-day period of time, we were able to come up with nearly $1 million in matching funds to get this grant request sent off. And we were really, really pleased that it was approved. Now, the agency itself was not the recipient. We are a partner in the effort. The recipient was the Flint Hills Regional Development Council that is headquartered out of Fort Riley. Okay? A couple other things that have happened within this time frame since the May summit, our area has been identified by Secretary Salazar, Department of Interior, as the Flint Hills as has been recognized as a key issue or key element to America's great outdoors. So the Flint Hills and our Kaw River State, not Kaw River State Park, but our Kaw River has been identified as the two key area focus that are being focused upon by the Department of Interior. That the authorizing agency that we're working collectively with with respect to the river trail issue is the National Park Service based out of Omaha. The U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service is our key coordinating agency with respect to the natural landmass of the Flint Hills overall. So we'll be working with those as well. The other thing that has been accomplished is that we've identified the fact that there is a need for a gateway facility to get people to stop. I-70 is a great corridor. It gets people from point A to point B pretty quickly. What we haven't done an effective job at is getting people to stop along the way to find out what's really going on in the state of Kansas. And so recently there was with the help of the U.S. Department of Commerce, a study that was completed to determine a potential location for a gateway facility that would be a welcome center to the Flint Hills. That was identified as the corner of I-70 and 177. Again, that is the identification, the feasibility study has been completed. We got a lot of work to do to get the money together to pull to get the facility built. So that's our next challenge with respect to that. The other thing that is really, there's been a lot of grassroots efforts going on, but there is a definite effort to encourage and enhance the availability of outdoor recreation in the Flint Hills region. One of the things that is being conducted as well is a feasibility study to determine for private landowners what the opportunity would be to develop horse trails on private land. The other thing is we have a wonderful group of grassroots people who have worked diligently to develop private or public access to this great outdoors via the Flint Hills Nature Trail, which is an abandoned and rail-banked former railroad facility or railroad track. The other things that we're working on is identifying the potential for partners with respect to a Flint Hills Lodge. The governor sees this as a real opportunity. It's sort of like that baseball field in Iowa. If you build it, they will come. Right now, the governor sees it as a true opportunity to build a state-of-the-art facility within the Flint Hills that will attract people to come to the area. Additional opportunities that we've identified is the fact that we have some real threats to the Flint Hills area. One of those happens to be Serratia leptospirosa. For those that aren't aware of that, what Serratia leptospirosa is, I'm sure several of our conservationists here would be happy to visit with you about it. But we will be conducting a second Flint Hills Visioning Summit on January the 17th. It will be taking place in Topeka, Kansas. For those that have an interest in becoming registered to find out more about what's going on in the Flint Hills and the Flint Hills efforts and the governor's initiatives with respect to the Flint Hills, please feel free to pick up a flyer. They're located over here on the table. Commissioners, we'd love to see you guys attend if at all possible. I think you'll find it very interesting to see what kind of efforts are being put forth without technically additional funding to our agency, but as a result, a direct result of partnerships to enhance the opportunity for outdoor recreation, to enhance the economy for the state of Kansas, to really promote the wonderful opportunities we have to hunt, fish, and recreate in the Flint Hills. So with that, any questions?
Are there any questions from the commission?
Thank you. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
We're working on some needed changes in the Kansas law concerning trails. And, right now the Kansas law discourages, almost prohibits building trails. So, if everybody can work with us on this and we will get some of these things to where we can really improve the opportunities for people to use the old rail trails.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Anything we can do to help. In fact, Chris and I had a discussion with respect to that this morning. So, anything else? All right. Thank you.
Okay. Let's have one more agenda item, the update on delivery of the voluntary public access, habitat improvement program, and then we'll take a short break. So Jake George and Tom Lang.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. We do have a PowerPoint and we'll be waiting to get up here. While we're waiting on that, I can go ahead and give you guys, since we have some new faces on the commission, since the last time I discussed anything about VPA HIP, I'll give you a rundown on the program and a little bit of background on it. VPA HIP stands for Voluntary Public Access Habitat and Center Program. It was from the 2008 Farm Bill, set up as a block grant format. The intent was to provide funding to states in order to allow additional either new or expansion of existing access programs for recreational use for fishing and hunting and the like. The grant itself was set up in a block grant format, meaning it's 100% federal dollars. There's no state match for the funds. The maximum that you were able to request was $2 million per year. Because of the timeline, as far as when the program and the request for proposals was rolled out from the Farm Service Agency, who was administering the grant, it was not until July of 2010 that request for proposals came out. And they were really wanting to get some of that money off of their books for that particular fiscal year for federal FY10. So we had to have those proposals in by August of 2010, and so we had about a month to pull that together. We did very well. We requested the full amount with plans to expand on both fisheries and wildlife side for access, as well as some habitat improvement, which myself and Tom will be going over here shortly. We did very well. We received $1.5 million per year for 3 years, the initial grant, but the funds were not dispersed as such. We received the FY 2010 and FY 2011 funds together, and that wasn't until August of 2011 that we actually had the funds that we could access. That was partly due to the programmatic environmental assessment that had to be completed prior to those funds being dispersed. With the minibus passed in November, the VPA HIP program was cut from the Title II of the Farm Bill. Because of that and the way the dispersal of funds was set up by the Farm Service Agency, no one will be receiving any 2012 funds for the program. So that leaves us with $3 million that we're able to use within the state. There were a total of 27 states. I think two of those were tribes. And it's unfortunate that it took so long in order to get the request for proposals out there, because it left almost 40% of the $50 million that was included in the 2008 Farm Bill unutilized. It's still out there because the FY12 funds will not be dispersed. The Kansas receiving the $3 million of that works out to, out of those 27 states, we alone received about 10% of those funds. We did extremely well. As far as I know, the only other state that did as well as we did is Pennsylvania. I know they also received $1.5 million for the first year. I'm not certain whether or not they got their second year's worth of funding, but I assume they did. The most difficult part of working on this grant thus far has been the unknowns from the Farm Service Agency. They were inexperienced in dealing with delivering a grant program, and as such, they leaned on the states to give them some guidance, but then had to wait on definite answers as far as what could be covered, what couldn't be covered, when were deadlines, what was meant by some of the language within the request for proposals. They had to wait for to find out what their decisions were on that, even after we gave them suggestions. Some of them ended up favorably, some of them did not. But because of the timelines, currently right now we have until September 30th of 2012 to complete obligating those funds. And according to the Farm Service Agency, obligating those funds, which this is a little bit different than any of the other grants I've worked with, obligating those funds means actually expending those funds. It doesn't just mean committing the funds contractually. We actually have to have the funds dispersed to the landowners who have signed up by September 30th, 2012. There is a potential for grant extensions on that, according to the latest from their grant coordinator. But we're moving forward and not counting on that. We're going to try to expend the funds by September 30th, 2012. And as Tom and I'll show you, we're doing pretty well in reaching that goal. Programs delivery for both sections has been pretty successful thus far. On the wildlife side, the first slide I have up here is just a statewide distribution of our 2011 walk-in hunting access program. As most of you know, we don't have any issues getting access on properties in the western half of the state. It's primarily the eastern and southeastern parts of the state where our urban populations are that we have difficulty gaining access. As a part of the main issue that we're facing right now on the properties that we have, turnover and loss of property, is the expiration of Conservation Reserve Program tracts. CRP tracts do make up approximately 60% of the almost 1.1 million acres enrolled in the walk-in access program in the state. The idea we had with regards to using the VPA funds within the allotted timeline, as well as confronting the issue of losing access properties to expiration of Conservation Reserve Program lands, and that being returned back to row cropping, was to say, okay, you can do row cropping on these properties. It may be somewhat highly erodible soils. That's why it was in the program in the first place. But we'd still like to keep you in the access program so long as you go ahead and sign up for, to the extent that you can, continuous practices of CRP buffers. Conservation Practice 33, upland game bird habitat, as well as state acres for wildlife enhancement, the CP38E. The initial focus for that was on the buffers. We are looking now, which you'll see in a moment, at whole field, our general CRP signups. The nice thing about continuous is that the continuous means that you can continually sign up for it. You don't have to wait for them to announce another general sign-up for the program. The only limitations are the statewide acreage caps for those. With the buffers, we set a minimum of 15% that we're looking at. The maximums are set by the particular practices themselves with the Farm Service Agency. But what we're looking at is a minimum of 15 and up to 50%, depending on the practice, of cropland acres that are ceded to native warm season grasses and forbs. The way this helps us is to incentivize folks to sign up for the buffers, whether it's a crop field now or whether it's CRP that's being, general CRP that's being broken out. The general CRP being broken out does still receive a $100 per acre sign-up incentive payment from us that they will not see receive from the Farm Service Agency because they're maintaining that as opposed to planting it. So there's an incentive on both sides. For somebody who does not have a buffers existing, we're doubling the sign-up incentive payment they receive for the acres that go into buffers. The kicker is they also have to be willing to allow public hunting access on the property, which includes the cropland buffers and any of the properties surrounding it that's deemed appropriate by the wildlife biologist for at least 10 years or equal to the length of the CCRP contract. Depending on the practice, some of those will go up to 15 years. So what we're signing up are 10 to 15 year access leases on properties where we know that it's going to remain with quality habitat on it because of the buffers that they're bound to through their CRP or CCRP contracts with the Farm Service Agency. With regard to general whole field CRP, off the top we said what we want to look at are from the last two signups, 2010 and 2011, so that we could maximize the number of years left on that, so that we weren't relying on the language within our agreement with them for hunting access in order for them to maintain that habitat. They also would be bound then with the Farm Service Agency to their CRP contract for maintaining that habitat. One of the things that we also said was CRP contracts, whether it was included originally or is amended in order to enroll in this, must maximize wildlife habitat enhancements. So food plots, wildlife plantings, or wildlife seed mixes on there. As well, they also had to be willing to allow public access on the property for 10 years whether their CRP contract expired before that or not, and maintain the conservation cover on the property throughout the life of the access agreement. So it might be a little difficult for you guys to see. We really have two different tiers with the walk-in hunting access program for payment. On the right, on the eastern portion of the, state, in the yellow, is what we consider a standard or a incentivized payment rate. And those have to do with the close proximity to urban counties, as well as historically low enrollment in the walk-in hunting access program. In the brown, on the left side, in the north central, we have not had historically low access. We have significant access in those areas, and that's set at the standard rate. The rates we're paying for voluntary public access were determined by looking at the average payment rate within those tiers across the state. So for the different access periods, we're still doing November 1 through January 31, September 1 through January 31, but we're also looking at year-round contracts where we also have spring turkey for April and May. And you can see the payment rates range anywhere from $2 per acre to $6 per acre, and that's depending on the portion of the state that you're in as well as the length of the access period. Continuous Conservation Reserve Program receives a $100 per acre sign-up incentive payment from us. They will also be receiving a $100 SIP from FSA, so that's essentially $200 when you're computing it. The CRP, we on whole field, we decided to go ahead and give them for a kicker on the access a $20 per acre sign-on incentive payment. Our current commitments. As I said, we only received the funds as of August of 2011. We spent a lot of time building the program prior to that, so that as soon as we received the funds, we were ready to start having folks sign contracts. Right now, between access and habitat, we're looking at about $530,000 committed on the wildlife side alone. That's over 9,200 acres of access. And remember, these are 10 to 15 years of access on each of those properties with quality habitat because of the CRP or continuous CRP buffers. So access portion makes up about 450,000 of those currently committed funds. And we've got contracts in about 18 counties where we've added properties. On the habitat side, which I was going to touch on a bit, you have to be willing on the habitat side to be enrolled in access or already be enrolled in access through our regular walk-in hunting access program or newly through the VPA program. As long as it's public access, it doesn't matter. But we're able to use the funds to fully fund habitat work on these properties. There's no cost share from the landowner so long as we have the commitment required on access contracts, which is up to projects up to $3,000, they have to have a three-year hunting access contract. So you can't sign up for 1 year, have fully funded habitat work, and then drop out of the program. Anything beyond that, for every $1,000 added to the project costs, we require an additional year on the access contract. Some of these have been fairly large. We're doing some big properties with eastern red cedar removal and tree shearing. So we have now some WEHA contracts that go out to 15 years as well in order to cover the requirements for access and get the full funding for the habitat projects. With that, I think I'll bring Tom up, and he's going to talk about the fisheries side of the VPA.
Well, it's always great to be before a break. I'm sure I'll keep you riveted as you think about water and using the restroom. Thank you for having me, commissioners. I want to start by talking about our fish program in general. 2011 was our 13th year in the fish program. We had maxed out in funding, and our lease rates were really not competitive anymore. So we'd been having a difficult time really selling our fish program out there. So the program had really stagnated, and it really needed a shot in the arm. And working with Jake, it was really great to be able to get these VPA funds Secretary Jennison's made additional commitments to the program, which is fantastic. And so this was really the shot in the arm that the program needed when it had stagnated. And it's really important because access is fundamental to participation. And we're in the business of getting people outdoors, fishing, hunting, these sort of things. Well, this program is a fishing access program, so it's important that it's very successful. So I'd like to talk today, since the program has been around for 13 years, we did have a foundation. We had a foundation of a program, but you can't put a 2,000 square foot house on a 500 square foot foundation. And so one of the first things that we needed to do was to increase the capacity of our program, what we could actually handle, take care of some of the fundamental needs so we could go out and take care of the program. Part of what we did was acquiring better and new databases for reporting, contracting, mapping capabilities. We've got to be able to show people where these properties are. We've got to be able to handle the payments in a timely fashion, in a good fashion, and do our federal partners justice by letting them know what we're doing on the ground for them. New contracts were needed. Additional equipment needs like fence crossers, cattle guards. Some of these things are vital selling points to get a landowner to sign up. They don't want people tearing up their fences to get to the ponds. So those things are really important too. And so, and we also had personnel limitations. You know, our fishery section is a very dedicated section like many of our people, but there's only so many hours in a day. And so it was great that we were able to get additional temporary help and overtime for a change. So that was great. It really increased our capacity. Apparently my PowerPoint went away, but I was going to say is that since we had the capacity set and we're able to expand our program, next thing we do is really get together and form what we need to do in our program to make this sellable to landowners, incentivize them so they're happy and they're going to get after it and sign up so we can get these access for the general public. We sat together and we had a committee of some of our more seasoned veterans in our fishery section, and we looked at our program and we thought, well, our program is pretty simple, but simple is not really getting it, and so we shouldn't be afraid to go ahead. Let me see here. Can we go down to about slide 43? That'd be great. We shouldn't be afraid to go ahead and add a lot of different things, a lot of different options to hit the landowners the way that we need to work with them to make all their issues be resolved. So they'll work with us and allow public access on our behalf. All right. Well, first and foremost, one of the big issues was that simply our lease rates were not competitive. You want to open up your pond for $42 an acre per year for anybody and everybody. You get a nice 20-acre pond, you want $800 a year. It just wasn't doing it. And so we really needed to increase our lease rates, and we did that. Our streams went up, especially highest priority streams. We did focus on our highest quality streams. We want to offer different experiences. Some parts of our state, like the eastern part of the state, we have lots of good impounded waters. Is that what we need to be offering for access to increase participation? Not necessarily. And so we looked at those things. What do we need? It's probably access to some of our streams, including paddle sports. One of the great things of the VPA program was that it allowed us to add paddle sports. Because our traditional program is funded with sport fish restoration money, it's limited to those that are fishing only. It's funded by anglers, it's for anglers. That's the model, and that's great. But when it comes to some of these streams, if people can't get on them, they don't value them, they're not going to protect them. And so having this VPA funds allowed us to add paddle sports and give bonuses to landowners who would allow people to simply canoe and kayak down their stream reaches. So we added a paddle sports bonus. We looked at areas of the state where we had low participation, or there are counties, believe it or not, in Kansas that don't have any fishing opportunities whatsoever. And so we wanted to offer sign-on bonuses to folks in those counties. If there's not a fish property, or if there's not a public water at all, we have sign-on bonuses set up for folks in those counties. We also feel that, say, you have a 15-acre pond that's open to, it may already be in the fish program, and we've got 15 acres of shoreline fishing access. This is a place that if somebody could bring a carry-in boat or launch a little John boat, that's another opportunity for them. So we wanted to offer incentives like bonuses for boating, or for year-round access. We are now going to have some properties up in the north central to northwest that are going to be year-round that offer some ice fishing opportunities will be great. So we want to fully utilize our partnership with these landowners as best that we can to offer diversified opportunities to our public. And so those things have really been a great deal for retooling our program. Now, when I talk about our base rates and our impoundments, our ponds, like I said, $42 an acre wasn't just cutting it. So when we went to reset what we're going to offer landowners, we looked about what is most important to us as a department. What counties is most important to increase acreage of ponds, which will in turn increase angling participation. So we developed a metric system, and I'm definitely not going to go through that and bore the heck out of you, but I will show you the map that we developed. This is our tiered approach. And when you look at this, our base rates are now $75, $100, or $125 an acre based upon what county you're in. And those tier one counties, when we look at these counties, these are the counties that we feel are most important to adding fish ponds. If we add fish ponds in here, we think we're going to get the biggest return in angling participation in these waters and on down. But still, we were underfunded. You see, even our lowest tier is higher than our traditional rate. Because we were underfunded, we just weren't competitive. So that's how we altered some of these things. And I think that's a really good thing. It's allowed us to get some properties going. So we've increased our capacity. We retooled the program to make it more attractive to landowners. So we're really good at keeping secrets about really good things in our agency. We decided not to do that this time. We wanted to go out and spread the word about the good things and try to help landowners understand what's being offered to them. So we've ran newspaper ads, online classified ads, Next Tech, Craigslist, press releases. We had a magazine article in November, December issue. We did three TV spots on the Ag AM show that runs out of Joplin, Topeka, and Wichita as well. We had online videos, and we purchased ads in specific ag publications, publications that go to landowners, that go to farmers, go to cattle, livestock operators. So Grass and Grain, High Plains Journal, Kansas Farmer, KAA Newsletter, Rural Messenger, and they have about a circulation of about 225,000 people. So that was really good for us to put those ads in their hands. This was not just fish, this was VPA as well. And I thought I'd just give you a quick look at the ads that we put out there. Specific phone numbers to call, addresses to websites, these sort of things. Some basic information, but also where to go and get more information. And it's been pretty good so far. Some of our early results, our biologists have been on the ground, and they've expanded our program by about 25%, which is pretty good. Added well over 400 new acres of ponds, several additional big river access sites. As you know, our big rivers are public, but you still have to have access to get on them. And so we do lease access sites to the Kansas, Arkansas, and Missouri rivers. And paddle sports to streams. We've added paddle sports to like the Marmaton River and some of our other existing cooperators, but additional new streams that we've signed up as well. One of the nice things about this is because of tiering our approach before, yes, a landowner could allow carry-in boats, or a landowner could allow year-round or all boats, but they weren't incentivized to do so. And because those are important to us as an agency, being that we incentivize them to add these additional items to it, we have had some of our traditional properties, our existing properties, expand what they offer at those. And so that's been a really nice deal as well. In fact, I'll tell one quick success story. We had a property that out in western Kansas that had been in for a long time. And when they saw they get an additional $25 an acre, they wanted to put in a boat ramp. And we'll put in boat ramps. We don't do concrete, but we'll put in a rock ramp to allow people to launch. And he didn't want a rock ramp, so they just put in a concrete ramp. So come on, that's fine, I'll put it in. So we put in a concrete ramp. We paid him an additional $25 an acre. And so now we have people that can not only shoreline fish there, but they can launch boats. And that's a really good thing. So that's some of our early results. And like I said, I don't want to take a lot of your time. You've got a busy agenda, but that's basically where we're going. We're still signing people up. We're out there charging. Our fisheries division is charging ahead to try and continually increase these access opportunities for our public. I have questions for Jake and I.
Anybody have any questions?
I've got a couple, Mr. Chairman. Do we have any fishing access that's not big river water?
Oh, absolutely. We have about 100 miles of stream access in the state.
Where would I find a listing of those at?
In our fishing atlas.
Okay.
And they're on the back table, Sheila? Excellent. Thank you.
Any other questions?
You can ask Jake a question, too. He won't get mad.
Do you have another question?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Let's take about a 10-minute break, 20 till 4. We've got a lot of stuff yet to cover.